And welcome to another episode of Dying to Meet You. My name is Angelie May, and I'm very privileged today to have with me someone who's making a big impact in the industry. And this is none other than Dr. Chu. Thank you so much for joining us on this podcast.
Thank you so much for having me here today.
Dr. Chu, you can give us an introduction about what you do.
Yes. Sure. So I am a home care doctor, and I see patients in their homes. I've been doing this since 2006. So that's 18 years already. And so, you know, in home care, you will get patients who are quite elderly and who have problems getting out of the house, right? And that's why they call a doctor in. And so with elderly patients, they have so many complex problems. They are also near the end of life. So it's quite natural that as an extension to what I see for them, then palliative care also is part of what I do.
So when you say home care, you were more providing care for people who may be not so mobile to
visit the clinic.
But now you have sort of broadened the scope to palliative care as well.
Actually, the reverse. So when I started out, it was mostly what I call acute visits. So patients will call, hey, I got a swollen knee or something. Right? I can't come out to see a doctor. Or I got diarrhea, I can't come out. So it's kind of a once-off visit. Beyond that, then slowly, as the thing evolved, it became more of building a relationship with the patient. You see them repeatedly, right? And then because you have that relationship, it kind of brings you with them towards the end. And that's how you go into the palliative care space.
So, you know, this is something that I often say about palliative care, is that I can't do what you do. To me, palliative care is such a challenging job because you are facing the dying face. And sometimes you connect with the family, you have a relationship. So how do you feel when things come to the end?
So it's very interesting, right? As I said, a lot of my patients are quite elderly. And reflecting on what I do and the patients I see, you cannot have two groups of patients. One is the elderly, the other group is the younger group, maybe with cancers, let's say. Right, because cancer can hit at any age, 50s, 60s, whatever. So with the very elderly folks, and nowadays elderly means 90 and above.
Yes.
Right. In the past, life expectancy wasn't so high. So patients die about 70 plus, 80 plus. But now we see patients 90 plus, 100. That's not uncommon anymore. So with the elderly patients, they have an expectation already. They kind of know. Right, and their mindset is such that, okay, I'm comfortable with whatever it is, right? So dying isn't so traumatic for these patients. But I think really it's much more difficult when we are treating and interacting with the younger group, 50s, 60s, 40s even, right? So I think even for myself, I find it harder to work with these patients as well. Because I think when you're young, there's so many things you haven't done or need to do. And when faced with the prospect that life is ending, then that's actually a very difficult thing.
Recently, I have someone asking me, what's my biggest fear? Yeah. So maybe, Dr. Xu, I should ask you, what's your biggest fear?
My biggest fear? To lead a meaningful life is what I want. So not having to lead a meaningful life is my biggest fear. Am I doing enough to help people?
I love what you say, because exactly when someone asked me what was my biggest fear, I said my fear is not dying or coming to the end of my life. My biggest fear is not finishing what I would like to do in this lifetime before I bid farewell to this world, right?
Absolutely.
Because I think right now we are in this space and time where we want to make a difference. And I think the biggest part for me is if I experience an acute death. So some people who may not know, acute death means you suddenly passed away, maybe die in your sleep, met an accident, or people who have chosen to end their own life. This is what we call acute death.
Yes.
And that's always very difficult. Your patient usually, how long are their life expectancy when they come to meet you?
Once again, two groups, right? So in the palliative circle, we talk about trajectories, right? You know patients, let's say if you have cancer, you know, okay, there's 3 months, 6 months, they decline, and then that's kind of expected. So that's where we come in as well, right? Maybe the last couple of months. But then the elderly is quite different, right? The elderly with, let's say, strokes or Parkinson's or dementia, they hang on, right? They decline very slowly. They get infections and then they may recover, and then they get another one, recover. So you never quite know when will be the last, right? But for these patients, generally, once you start to see them decline, we think maybe a year, that kind of thing. There are certain signs that we can use to gauge, right? And guess that maybe time is short. But short means a year, right? Mm. Different from when we talk about cancer now, that short means months, right? So quite different. So this is kind of the time frames that we have.
Maybe we can backtrack to when you start to venture to palliative care. How was it like for you when you have to break the news in terms of how much time left for their loved ones?
Of course, I don't know how to do it.
Wow, it must be tough.
It's not easy. I really didn't know how to do it, right? And then after that, I kind of like, did I do it correctly? It's one of those things takes practice.
Mm.
Right? And of course, the more experience you have, then maybe it's easier to break the news.
Mm. Yeah. Because I'm sure the first time it was so difficult. And have you ever had different reaction coming to you? Because we know that grief, you know, they come in different stages.
Yeah.
Even clients who come to me, the bereaved family, they are all at different stage of grief. Mm. So what was your experience like? Had there been any very difficult where they tell you like, you are lying, or like, I don't believe you, in denial state, or any extreme cases that you...
Fortunately, not so dramatic.
Not like what I see in the TV.
Okay. No. Not so bad. But of course, you know, they will question your professional judgment. You say, are you sure? In the earlier days, sometimes you're not so sure, right? So you also will wonder, is it really like this? More of the kind of uncertainty. It's not so much difficult reactions coming from the family as such.
Because my recently, I have one family who reached out to me just before the auntie passed away.
Mm.
So I got a call, and then she said, "Oh, can you?" He said, "Could you come because my aunt is not well." So immediately I went to the house, and I remember this was like a two-story house. So I met the sister, and then of course the nephew who called me, and then we started making an arrangement. And then I keep hearing the sister, the one who's about to go. And she was making this, I would say maybe death rattles, like a sound.
Gurgling
yeah.
sound.
And then she asked me, Anjali, do you think she will last another week? Because it's her birthday this Sunday, and we would like to celebrate for her. And I remember this was probably like Wednesday. So I said, oh, just let her know that you want to celebrate, you know, ask her to hang on and all that. I mean, I'm not professionally trained. Mm. So she mentioned that the hospice, home care came, and then they actually said, oh, she has maybe 1 or 2 weeks. And then she said, what do you think? I did tell her, I said, actually, most of the time, by the time I come in, the patient has already passed.
Yeah.
But I can only sense it based on my experience with my grandmother, who has passed away during COVID. That when she was having all this, you know, sounds, it probably took her a few days only. Yeah. So unfortunately, I met her on a Wednesday, and then she passed away on Friday.
Mm.
Yeah. And I remember this because she actually asked me, would you like to come and see my sister? And I struggle with that. The reason is because I was brought up, you know, my dad was a funeral director. And my mom has always told us, don't visit people in the hospital, or don't visit people when they are about to be the end of life. So I asked her why, because we were very young, right? I don't understand, why can't we go and visit? He said, oh, because people pantang. And then they will say that, oh, funeral director come, why are you here? My mom is still, you know, still healthy. Why are you visiting her?
Mm.
So it's like, niao lai na sheng yi, you want to get the business way before she passed away.
I see.
So there was this pantangness, and I still struggled with it today. And I sort of politely declined and said, I would prefer maybe when she passed, then I come in. And then because there are some people who wouldn't like that a funeral director come next to the patient and then tell them, or like check on them, because I'm not professionally trained.
Mm.
So that was my biggest struggle. Until today, I still feel that when people are end of life, I tend not to pay them a visit, even though I've been asked.
So that's interesting, right? But who's asking? The
family members.
The family members or the patients themselves?
Family members.
Family, okay. Mm. So I guess there are certain sensitivities, and I would feel the same way you feel as well.
Yeah, it's a bit uncomfortable for me because of the request. I mean, if I go in to see someone who I know as a friend, I think, yes, I would love to do that. But if I'm coming in as someone who's a funeral director making arrangement, then I didn't feel that I would, because maybe, you know, some family members may be around and they will be very sensitive. I ever had one episode. I went to the family to plan for the wife's funeral, and just everything was done. Just when I was about to leave, the brother came in, the eldest brother, and started shouting at the husband, saying that my sister is not even dead yet. Why do you get her to come in? Right, so they started to argue. And then in the end, it was a very uncomfortable spot. I stood there, was thinking, I can't say anything to appease them. And then the husband just beckoned me like, Anjali, you just leave first, it's okay. So they started shouting after I left. So I think that's, the sensitive part, you know.
It is true, it is true. But when I see patients who are close to their time, when you see death rattle is days, I actually often tell them it's time to prepare. I tell them, maybe you want to reach out to your undertakers first, right? So that when the time comes, right, then you're not flustered, you know, you're not like panicking, don't know where to call and that kind of thing. So actually, the family dynamics is of course important, right? And every patient is important, right? How the situation, the illness, how it is. So it's actually a good thing to prepare. Yeah, but what prevents this maybe is the family dynamics. Right, if there's some kind of disagreements in the family, they feel, hey, my dad's not going to die so soon, but why are you saying he's going to die, right? And that's when there will be conflicts. That's when it's difficult. So part of my job, right, when I go in to see such sick patients, right, is actually also to get everybody on the same page, right? To say, okay, look, here's the situation, right? It is actually the truth that, you know, your mom has got limited time. Then once everybody is aware, right, then all these things can proceed smoothly. So very recently, I also had one case. This one is, I think, about 90 or so. Dementia patient. So home care, I've been seeing her for about a year. And then she started to decline, eating less and less for maybe a couple of weeks. So it's quite interesting. She's a smoker. So the first sign of trouble is she don't want to smoke already. So don't want to smoke, right? Then something is not right. Then she became weaker, weaker. Then after that, became quite big, and it's quite clear that she's deteriorating. And so for such patients who are very elderly, there isn't a benefit to pushing them to hospital again and again and again also, because when you send such patients to hospital, there's actually quite a bit of suffering involved. Number one, you know, they get plucked out of their home, right? The family can't visit them so often. Number two, at home, the helper can look after this patient. When you go to the hospital, it's one nurse to many patients, right? And the nurse is very busy, right? And of course, the most important thing we could say is that the treatment may not be useful also, right? Because the body is already weak, 90 years old, organs failing, you pump in antibiotics, may not benefit, right? So, patient stays with a daughter, but have other daughters who once in a while will kind of see, right? So this family, the home that the patient is in, then the daughter is ready lah. She knows, right? It's because she's seen the mother all along, right? So she knows, I told her, it's not going to be very long, maybe 1 week until she goes. But the one who comes to visit once in a while doesn't quite agree, right? Says, I think you should send her to the hospital. He says, it's not right that you can't feed her, but that actually, because when they are dying, they shut down. So they eat less and less and drink less and less. So actually it's a very natural process, but they don't understand that. So finally, they asked me to come in again, and this time with this sibling inside. And that's when I explained to her everything, then she finally got it. So good thing, because after that, on the same day, she passed away. So actually, it's the underlying dynamic. So when we treat the patient and palliative care, right, we're not just treating this patient. Actually, you're trying to look after the whole family also. So actually, if everybody's aligned, then if you make preparations, right, to get things ready so that once the patient passed away, they know who to call for death certification, they need to know who to call to do the rest of the arrangements. Actually, that's a good thing.
I agree. Yeah. Actually, as you were sharing this story, there were so many stories that came to my mind about managing family. That because a lot of people have this expectation that, hospital actually provides better care. That we don't have the facility or we don't have the means, there will be someone professional, we may not be able to rush you to the hospital, etc. And it's also towards the end, that a lot of the patient family ask me, what do you think I should do before their loved one passes away? They will meet me and say, mom is still in the hospital, but 孩子吵着要回家, wants to go home. To be honest, most people, I've met so many people, they really prefer to die in the comfort of their home, to die in a room that's surrounded by their loved ones. So sometimes I ask them at the end of the day, like you said, if you send them to the hospital, do they really get the comfort of knowing that they are at home and that they will be passing where they are comfortable and most familiar? And I think a lot of family were like that. But I also had people who said, oh, but maybe we need to go to a hospice. Because hospice, you have care, you have that comfort. But I guess when you're doing home care in palliative, what you're trying to do is manage that pain at the comfort of their home, right?
Absolutely. Surveys have shown it, right? Most patients, 70% or more, really prefer to pass on at home. But that can only be done with the right support, right? So that's why palliative care services are important to support the patients in the home. But it's true that sometimes when patients really can't handle it, then maybe the hospice, inpatient hospice, is a more suitable option. There are many cases, of course, where we'll try and manage the patient at home until a time when they really cannot take it, they're too stressed out, they don't know how to do this or that. Then we have to send the patient to an inpatient hospice to be cared for until their last days.
So maybe we can talk a little bit more about technical stuff. ACP, Advanced Care Planning. Am I right to say that when people reach a certain stage in life, the medical doctors or practitioner, you will have to step in if the person has not done ACP? Or is it something that you all will advise the patient, family, or patients themselves to sit together with the facilitators or the nominees to arrange?
So ACP can be done at all stages of the patient's life or journey. At the very early stage when all is quite well, you know, like, then it's really just to open that conversation about the meaningfulness of life, as you say. But in the later stages, then of course, it becomes more important, right? Because things can happen, things are more likely to happen, then that's true. So I think ACP can be done by a lot of different ways, and different organizations can do it. So we also will be very happy to help facilitate that conversation with whoever needs it.
Yeah, I think the conversation is needed, and sometimes it's better to have a facilitator, because you know, I find that even for funeral directing, when you say that you are taking care of the patient, but actually you are also managing the expectations of the family members. Similarly for funerals, so, yeah, we have people who come in, and I've experienced so many where people are maybe in different stage of their grief, right? So maybe some is in denial, some are angry, but not at me. He just happened to be angry with maybe things that he didn't do, with the fact that loved one passed away and the doctor didn't save him or her. But now you start to realize, yeah, everyone needs the space. We can take time, we can come back again when everyone is ready. And also dealing with the differences, like maybe in terms of, oh, mom said this outfit, the other one said, no, use the outfit that she wear to the wedding. Then you have different opinions.
Yeah.
So always good to give the instruction, let your loved one know what and how you have planned, or if you have planned, which funeral company you have appointed. Then you know there's a little bit more calmness when you come to the transition, rather than you karang gabo at the end, and then who do we call? And they may be taken advantage if they didn't choose properly in terms of who the funeral company is, and they just go with a recommendation maybe, and they didn't have a good experience. So I mean, coming back to you, your background and your exposure, you being in this field for so long, do you ever get burnout?
Yeah, of course. Right. So and that's why, you know, I have to step back sometimes. Right. I can't take on every case, because if I'm not in a good shape to see a patient, right, then I may be doing more harm. Yeah. So it's then therefore important for me to also sometimes really set boundaries. I mean, I say this, right, it's not because I am selfish, but it's because it's necessary. Right. Because we need those things so that I can do a proper job.
So what's your outlet? For when you get, you know, burnout, or in certain, when you need to step back, you go running or you do sports?
Yeah, sports is nice. Swimming, going for a walk, Netflix is good.
Oh, that's good. Now everyone is like Netflix. It's true. Yeah. It's true because you get actually I get a lot of inspiration from Netflix. There are movies about palliative care.
Yes.
Recently, I don't know whether you caught this show called Plan 75. And why 75? Because it's a show where in Japan at 75 years old, you could choose to have euthanasia.
Oh.
And because, you know, aging population where the dependency ratio is getting lower and lower, so you could choose to end your life. So it was a very, very impactful movie, but also very reflective, very sobering. Yeah, it made me think a lot like, wow, if we don't resolve this problem, we may be a problem in the future. Maybe we don't have good support system, aging population, and we are growing older. Like you say, elderly is 90, or maybe even 100 over years old, and we pass. We may not have the means to prepare ourselves for those days. So you can opt your life out at 75. So they give you a very lovely plan, right? So, oh, you just have to check yourself in, put a drip, and then you just drift to sleep. Yeah, so that was the movie that I thought about euthanasia.
Oh.
So I have to be honest, before I knew about palliative care, we're talking about maybe 15 years ago, I actually told myself, wow, if I am at certain stage in my life where I can't function, I can't do the things I do, actually maybe that would be my option to have euthanasia. But later on when I understood about what palliative care is, then I realized it's about management of pain. I mean, euthanasia is not allowed, it's permitted in Singapore, but what's your view about that?
So actually, once a bit of technicality. So there's a difference between euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. So in euthanasia, the physician actually does the act of ending the life. In physician-assisted suicide, then it's like, okay, the doctor prepares everything, right? Then you press the button. Right, so you press the button and then, or you give the injection or something like that, and then you're the one who initiates it. So I think physician-assisted suicide is legal in certain countries, but there are a whole host of issues and controversies surrounding those things. One might argue that people only think about such things if there's no such thing as palliative care, right? If there was no way to relieve my pain, then I have to think about this, right? And if you think about it that way, then, well, it's understandable, right? I mean, it's about suffering and ending suffering, right? So it's neither white nor black. Nobody can say it's wrong or right. There are many ways and many angles we can talk. And this is a huge topic.
Never ending. Right? I think our podcast topic, will go
and
hours.
It's a huge moral, ethical minefield that, it's hard.
Yeah, and I think that's always a struggle, like whether, I think moral issue, religious belief, there's so many facets, right? Yeah, and it's hard. And I always remember towards the end of my grandma's life, she asked me to relieve her pain, right? So why do patients towards the end always feel this, even though we give her morphine, but she said, well, she was like, oh, 带我走,我很痛,很痛. So, how can we, you know, comfort them? Actually, I was at a loss of words, you know, even though I'm in the funeral, or my families are all in the funeral, but we don't know what to say to help comfort her. We were just there to like, okay, let me massage. And the pain is, I don't know, is it nerves? What is it that she's going through?
So I think at the end of life, when the systems are shutting down, there can be many kinds of abnormalities going on. The electrolytes can be upset, right? There can be high calcium, whatever. Those things can cause pain, right? There can be muscle breakdown or whatever. And those kinds of things can be painful as well. Circulation may be poor. So if let's say your hands, they don't get the blood going through, that can be painful as well, right? So, but that's the whole idea behind palliative care. Right? It's the physician's job to figure out what is the source of the pain and how can I relieve that pain? And you know, there are so many ways to deliver pain medications. We have morphine and so on. And not just orally, so because at the end of life science, patients can't eat. So that can be given as a patch, injections and whatnot. But that's really the physical side, okay? I mean, when we talk about pain, we also talk about it as total pain. Pain is pain, physical pain. Then there's also suffering, right? That your grandma may be distressed by it. And so that one, actually, you know, your family's presence, that kind of thing, it's actually the best you can do. Right? It's very hard to say, I want to make this person happy in the face of pain. Not possible. Right? There's a limit to how much we can do and how much we can help. So we got to be aware of that as well. That can be the reverse as well. So there can be minimal pain, but a lot of suffering. So for example, patients, if you haven't touched them, right? Then they shout. So that's the mental component, much more than the physical pain. So there's anxiety and all that, right? So you got to see both, right? Both are suffering. So if it's like this, sometimes we have ways to help the patient. Also, there are some drugs to reduce anxiety and you know, make the patient a bit less scared and fearful, right? And of course, family talking to them, in patients who are more well, counselling can help. It's a whole big picture there.
Yeah, so yeah. You see, that's why exactly I can't do what you do, because there's so many facets to it, to administer, to be sensitive. Because when you're talking about that, I just recall my aunt who has cancer. She suffered for, she's fairly young when she has cancer, and towards the end, we can't even touch her. Yeah, she was just in pain constantly, and she's like, don't touch me. It's very painful. So it's like one thing that we want to help alleviate their pain, but it's another thing to feeling helpless, standing there like, wow, what can we do to help? Is there any advice that you could give to people who may be taking care of their family members who are towards the end of life?
So, I mean, let the doctors sort out the physical stuff, right? What, as family members, what you can do is provide them the emotional support, right? And also to support yourself, or like I say, right? Same, right? I said about taking care of my own mental health. So same thing, right? So maybe realizing that there are limits to what you can do, and there's only so much you can do to help this patient. And if you've done it, then that's it, right? If you can't expect more of yourself, you know. Otherwise, then if you get sad or if you get distressed, then you can't also help your parents or something like that.
Yeah, I think to help others first, we need to help ourselves.
Yes,
it's so important.
Yes, that's right.
So, I mean, having seen so many patients, has there been any patient that has sort of impacted you or changed your way of belief?
It's probably a gradual thing. So each patient you see, there's something there, but you know, one's perspectives can never be changed just by one patient, I think, right? But having seen so many patients, then slowly you get to realize that actually dying may not be so terrible.
Okay, please elaborate.
As part of what I do, I also sign death certs. I've got certified patients have passed away. 15 years ago, when I go into a family to do the certification, I very often get people crying and very sad and in distress. But these days, much less. Do you find that as well?
I resonate with you, yeah.
Right? So why this is happening, right, is, we must congratulate the good work of the hospice services, the palliative care services, preparing the patients for the end of life journey. I think it is largely because of that, and largely because they've been supported through and they realize what this is all about. Then they don't get into that kind of situation when the time comes. Right? So, you know, when you see this, then you realize actually how we take this can be changed one, right? And it can become better, right? So, you know, in that sense, slowly, I say 15 years, right? That's how long it took to see the change. 10, 15 years, right? So slowly, you also realize that actually it's not that bad, right? It's a fact of life, right?
I always believe palliative care or healthcare, when you transition to us, we want to have a seamless transition so that we don't have families to be distressed. Yeah. But what are the other areas, in your opinion, can be better improved?
Yeah, actually, we are very happy that, the initiatives are going this way and that people are placing importance on palliative care. So we're definitely very happy to be part of this journey. I think at the end of the day, palliative care and care for the elderly and care for the dying It's very much a human type of care that we render, right? Of course, the whole technical stuff need to be there, right? We need to have the doctors and nurses know about it. They need to know the proper drugs and whatever to give. But I think the human dimension is still very key. And that may be something not at the forefront, but understandable, because it's so hard, right?
But I think also sometimes people ask me, Anjali, you must be desensitized because you've been in the industry for so long. For me, I beg to differ. I really feel every time when I see certain death, it still, in some way, affects me. That's why I said mental health, mental wellness is so important. And in my line of work, I have taken care of a fair number of people who have chosen how they want to, or when they want to exit life. And it's very unfortunate because they look so bubbly, they're full of life, they're so happy in the public eye, and all the friends never sense it. And that's where it hits you that, wow, I need to watch out for these people. Because we ever had a case where she actually pre-planned her funeral with us. And we didn't see any sign. My team, there were three of them who met her maybe three times in a total of 6 hours. No one, none of these three members in my team recognized or saw any sign that she was depressed. But then she took her life. But having planned everything. So it was very difficult even for me because she has two sisters. I also have two sisters and a brother. And I knew they had so many questions, right? Then how do you deal with that? So there's also this element of, if I have been there, would I have caught it? Would I have helped? Would I have changed? Yeah, so these are always the question that people who have to go through a death that is chosen, family members or friends, they always ask this question, what could I have done? And even mental, you know, mental wellness, I often say people need help. Don't brush it away. Don't say, oh, get over it. You know, why are you always so depressed? Yeah, maybe they really need help, and just be aware of all these signs, right? So, I mean, having spoken so much, and then maybe I'm just curious because I follow a lot of shows on Netflix. What are you watching now?
I saw a very interesting movie. Three elderly friends who in their younger days, they were killers. And then they became old, right? Then they advertise their services to kill elderly people who don't want to be there anymore. So these are veteran Hong Kong actors.
It's a Hong Kong show.
So I watch all kinds of stuff and comedies and sometimes foreign language films just for the kicks.
There's many palliative care film nowadays. I feel like there's a lot more awareness. Even the recent one that I mentioned, Good Goodbye, if you haven't caught Good Goodbye, it's actually a show that's filmed locally about palliative care. Just make sure you bring tissue, so at least you prepare yourself. Like recently, there's a very big viral thing that's going on, and we were talking about it before the show, the living funeral. For those people who don't know, a living funeral usually for people towards the end of their, when they know their expiration date, they will want to throw like a living funeral just before they pass to invite the people they love. It doesn't need to be a funeral, meaning there's no casket. Basically, just like a gathering where they share messages. So to, I think, express the four phrases, I'm sorry, I forgive you, I thank you, and I love you. So what's your opinion about living funeral?
I definitely go for it.
Hey, me too. Yes, why would you definitely go for it?
No, I think being able to be there and to say all those things that need to be said is quite important for me to have peace of mind. Right? So after I say the things I've said, then I think I can go peacefully. Right? Without it, sometimes maybe it's not so, you're still not so comfortable, maybe not so good. Yeah. So I think I'd still, I would go for it.
Wow, so maybe make your patient go for it too. Let's do a living funeral. Yeah, so I think a living funeral can help to close a lot, have closure, not just for you, for the people who you leave behind, especially the surviving family members who may have certain 心结, you know, like, oh, I want to say sorry to her. I have this experience of a sort of a living funeral, but a very small one where I helped to officiate. And I remember the sister step up to talk about her brother. So she said something along the line where she wanted to seek for forgiveness from the brother for something she did when she was a kid. And she felt that was something that haunted her. And then we were waiting for the brother to respond. And then the brother said, "When did that happen?" He has no idea at all.
I see.
At the moment, I realized, oh, what really bothered you? Actually, the person who really cares don't mind it. So sometimes it's better to just trash it out and like let it go, live in the present, rather than you hold on to something like, oh, 耿耿于怀, like, hey, did I, should I say sorry? And you know, Asian, we don't express our word of affirmation. And I think, yeah, don't wait until tomorrow to express all these words. So living funeral, that's something that I think going forward, you know, if more patients can talk about it through a living funeral, then you still have a funeral, but just that you get to hear all the things that people would like to say about you rather than you're lying in a box in a funeral where you probably can't hear it. So want to know more about Living Funeral, you can actually read the book by Mish Elburn, Tuesdays with Maury. The whole concept came from that book many years ago when I read it. So I'm very glad that Singapore, we are picking up and then we have perhaps more maybe experience with Living Funeral coming to time. And maybe just one last question so that we could sort of wrap this up. What is your experience when people want to talk about their funeral but maybe family members don't want, or family members would like to know but family the patient may not be ready? How do you help to bridge this topic of preparation?
Actually, just be upfront. Be upfront about it. I think trying too hard, also it's not so easy to do. So my approach is I'll just be upfront about it and tell them the truth about things. Of course, that doesn't mean that you do it in a very insensitive way, right? You just bridge it slowly and then you just tell them. But the truth is always the best.
But what if, for family members, how do they bridge? So for instance, maybe I've been asked many times and I wanted to hear your view, where family members ask me, how do we talk about this topic with my mom who's dying? Mom is not talking about it because they, maybe in their mind, they are fearful of like, oh, what if mom say, hey, yeah, why you think I will die? I'm not going to die so soon.
So probe, right? Probe what the mom knows and what does she want to know before going further, right? If she says, yeah, I know I've got something brewing, but I don't know what is it, and I know it's quite bad, that's a kind of signal to say she's a bit there already, right? Some of them say, I don't know, I'm quite okay. Then of course, leave it aside. They may really not want to know, right? So I think the best way is to probe and see what's going on with the patient.
I mean, one patient I remember, the daughter wasn't sure whether to probe. Like, I don't know what color my mom likes. So I said, why don't you buy some flowers, right? You visit her in the hospital, you buy some flowers. I just ask, hey, ma, you like this color or not? And let her see what she says. All right, thank you so much for joining us for this session. And yes, Dr. Chu, I must give you a book, My Dying to Meet You book. And I'm sure very soon you can also have a confession of a palliative care doctor. I would love to read your story and then to get to know how we can help patients and the family members.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you. All right, so until the next time, join us again for another episode of Dying to Meet You. See you. Thank you.